clear the land for part of our family, the Bowman family in Falls Church, Virginia. And the Bowman family owned property, and my niece is going back to 1844, and we weren't supposed to own, blacks weren't supposed to in Virginia. And so we still own a lot of between the church and the school. And I watched my grandmother build this house that my mother now lives in. And it really planted a seed. A lot of seeds were planted by my parents, by my relatives. And I think that that's really critical when you talk about young people and why things are going so bad, because nobody's talking to the kids. Nobody is showing them how to do anything. And we wonder why they're so, this flash mob stuff, because they don't really have any direction. You know, there isn't a parent, there isn't a mentor, there isn't a guardian. And anybody can be that. So that's what's really important to me. So when Kathy was talking about this, Kathy was Kathy is a very thorough, detail-oriented person. And I thought I was detail-oriented, but she really is. But she made me think about, you know, about my work and about my teaching and things like that. And so, you know, I've kind of shifted gears. Because what I think is important is, I've always thought that the message was important, but equally as important for me right now is the preservation of a culture of ceramics that was never given it to just do. You know, when I was at PCA, they would always talk about Japanese and Chinese ceramics, up the yin yang, and that's an old term. I used to ask them, I said, well, what about African ceramics? So, okay, well, what about indigenous Americans? Okay, Marie Martinez. We were never exposed to it. We were never encouraged to look at it. And if you talk to my mother, she will tell you, oh, if you tell her no, that means go. So, you know, so I used to, at PCA, there was a young man who had an accent. It was, you know, my color. And I used to kind of, I guess it would be called stalking people now. But I would kind of, you know, follow him around. And he told me his father was a king, but I said, yeah, right, you know. And as it turns out, in African Art Magazine, they did three articles on his father. He was a king. And look, and he married this other girl that we went to school, because I'm going, yeah, right. So that, you know, it was like my thing that when, since a child, I want to go to Africa and learn ceramics, because I'm thinking if it's, if, you know, we had three books on our table when I was growing up. Jet Magazine, Ebony, and Time. And I would read them. And one time, I was still in high school, I think, or during high school, that Time did this cover that had a black Adam and Eve. And this is after they found still the oldest known Homo sapien remains from Ethiopia. And I'm saying, okay, Ethiopia is in Africa. They're in Africa, man, they're people, they make pots. I mean, that was always kind of like my relationship. And so I was just more determined to go and find out. And so I got a chance to go with Festac. And I don't know if you know what Festac is, but Google it. It was an amazing experience for me. It was the first time that I was able to go to, after growing up in segregated Virginia and being told, you know, sit in the balcony, you know, and we used to throw popcorn, I'm sorry. You know, because, you know, we were kind of pissed. You know, why we have to sit in the bathroom? You know? And I remember O'Roy Chalk on DC Transit, and in Virginia, you had to ride in the back of the bus. I remember this. And so as soon as we crossed the DC line, legally, we could move to the front, so all the blacks moved to the front. I mean, so I come from that kind of background. And, you know, that's the way it was. So to go to a place where every billboard had black people on it, every TV commercial had black people on it, I mean, it's a big difference. And if you're a Euro-American, you don't realize it because you're always undergirded. You know, visually, you're always undergirded. And my daughter was little, and you know, they do the rush in October to make the kids bug their parents about buying toys. I told her, I said, if they don't look like you, they're not talking to you. You know, and somebody said, well, why would you say that? I said, it's kind of multifaceted and interrelated, because those people in the commercials are actors. Well, if you're not not hiring black actors, they're not working. So it's the same kind of cycle, you know, and so I just kind of, I didn't really take a stand. I just figured it out. I'm going like, no. You got to hire some black actors and none of that Stephen Fletcher stuff, you know. And maybe some young people don't know him. He's another part of my family that came in. Come on in. My work talks about my life. It talks about things that have impacted me. You know, for instance, Katrina, you know, was a very upsetting kind of situation. And I was artist in residence down at Tougaloo, and there was a woman who was a Southern Belle, and she was teaching, you know, still life painting, and she didn't let anybody in her class. You know, in my class, anybody can come in and do something. And so we each gave a presentation, and I started talking about the atrocities of Katrina and how people lost their lives and, you know, how horrible it was. And so her understanding of what I was saying is, well, yes, I lost a lot of property. Well, I snapped. I said, you just don't get it, do you? I said, you're talking about your property? I said, did your property die? You know? So, you know, she got up and left. You know, but it wasn't over. So anyway, so that's basically what I do. I deal with a lot of women's issues. Those pieces in the case are about genital mutilation. And one time a woman said to me, aren't you tired of doing that? You know, we're tired of seeing this. I said, well, when it stops, I'll stop. Mm-hmm. Just that simple. So, you know, I've been going to between West Africa since 1977. And my whole mission was to work with villages so I could learn the technique. And it's very different from what I was being taught at PCA. Very different. And I used to teach at the Pennsylvania Advancement School at 5th and Luzerne. And that made me leave Philadelphia because if we had students absent, 9 times out of 10, they were dead because of gang war. And I tell people talk about California, and I said, no, the first place that had some serious gang war was Philadelphia. And so, you know, all of those things have impacted me. But I just I love doing play, I love teaching, and now I'm on a mission. I have this project called Women's Pottery, Women's Pottery House. and basically, I'm trying to do a demonstration house in Ghana and one in Nigeria. The village that I worked in Nigeria no longer exists and was one of the hugest pottery centers. And it doesn't exist because the owner wanted to sell the land, so he kicked the women off. Mm-hmm. Now, there were some women who owned their ibu. Ibu is a Yoruba word for workshop. And so when I went back, I didn't go back for a long time because it was dangerous. They had like armies of road bandits. And so I kept in touch with my friends, and finally they said, okay, you can come back. So in 2009, I went back, and they told me my teacher had died. And I said, oh, God, I can't believe, you know, I had to wait all this time. And I had to lecture at the university, we had to pass the village, and something kept telling me, go. I found her. She wasn't dead. It was her mother that had died. And the reaction I had, I didn't expect. I fell on the floor crying, on the ground crying, and this little woman's trying to console me. So I really, I asked that question when I was younger to my mother.